This is Carol Murphy, and you're listening to Heartstock Radio. Thanks, everybody, for being here. We've got another fantastic program lined up, and this evening we have Carie Coe. She's actually physically here in the studio, and in just a bit, she's going to come back, and we'll hear all about what she's been up to. She's actually the recipient of the Woman Entrepreneur of the Year Award that was given to her by the Local Development Corporation. And there's so many things that we have to talk about. I just hope we can fit it all in. Go ahead and listen just for a moment, and we'll be right back.
As I was walking the ribbon of power, I saw above me that endless skyway. I saw below me that golden valley. This land was me, you and me.
We're here with Carie Coe in the studio. Carie, hi.
Hi. Thanks for having me.
Thanks for being here. Carie is also a DJ here. I have to throw that little tidbit in. So it's really nice to see you here sitting kind of on the other side of the table, so to speak, because I feel like you have a lot to share with our community and with our listeners in general, far and wide. And I'm going to try and stretch this conversation a little bit so that the impact of what is going on here locally in Butte, I've always felt that it's far-reaching and that there are many communities, not just in the United States, but all over the planet, that face some of the issues that we have here in Butte. Hmm. So, Carie, please tell our listeners who you are and what you've been up to.
Okay, well, it could be a long or short story, hopefully. I grew up here in Butte. We moved here when I was 6, and my dad got a job teaching at Tech. So I grew up here, went to school here since first grade, graduated Butte High, 93, and then moved out of state to go to undergrad in University of Oregon. At that point, I really wanted to get away from Butte. So I went to University of Oregon and ended up studying abroad in Vietnam my junior and senior year, and fell in love with the country and ended up taking 5 years to graduate because I stopped caring about undergraduate education and just wanted to be in Vietnam. So I kept going back, and then did graduate and went back, ended up teaching English there, working for a U.S. NGO, working for a U.S. law firm, and then went back to grad school, realizing that I needed more of an education. I wanted to get into economic development at the time, development policy. And so I went to get a master's, professional master's in San Diego. And as that was winding up, I really realized I wanted to do research. So I applied for a PhD program in political science and ended up going to UCLA and got my PhD in political science there, and did a postdoc at Berkeley for a year, and then got a teaching job in Portland in 2009 and taught college there for 6-7 years, I think, at Lewis and Clark College. And then as tenure was approaching, it became apparent I wasn't going to get it. So, and by that time, I was a little bit fed up with academia, so I started to look into other options and became a real estate agent, actually, for a year in Portland, and realized I kind of enjoyed that job, but also realized I wasn't going to cut it, probably, in terms of making enough in commissions to pay for my life in Portland. And it kind of made sense to start thinking about a life change. So I, for years, you know, I'd been coming back to Butte twice a year because my whole family's here. And I love Butte, and I've always been torn when I would go home, you know, back to Portland from visiting Buttes. And one of my last visits, I remember my friend Celeste chided me because she said, you know, you're always saying you're going to move back to Butte, but you never do. And it struck me that, you know, maybe it's time. So I moved back to Butte, and I sold my house in Portland and used the money I got from that to buy a building here in Butte. So I've been fixing up an old building and trying to make it work.
I can really relate to that, what you just said about that torn feeling, you know, every time I would come back here, kind of a similar experience every time I would come back after leaving, having grown up here, there would be this little, you know, tug at my heart.
Absolutely.
Yeah. That this was really home. So I'd like to talk a little bit about, you know, the building. 103 East Broadway. And
so technically it's 101 to 105 East Broadway.
Okay. Multiple addresses. That's impressive. That tells you a little bit about the building, doesn't it? So we were talking about this a little bit earlier before we came on the air also. Can you paint a little bit of a picture for our listeners who maybe know absolutely nothing about, they don't know anything about Butte or the number of buildings that we have here that are empty? Can you talk?
My whole childhood is based in running around those empty buildings, I guess. Butte, you know, is an old mining town that at the turn of the 20th century had a population of over 100,000 people, I believe. And so it was built, you know, very cosmopolitan on the hill with this beautiful uptown with these beautiful apartment complexes, brick apartment complexes, often with commercial spaces in the bottom and apartments upstairs or multiple floors of apartments. And many of those now in Butte and my whole life, because we moved here when I was six in 1981. So that tells you how old I am. you know, they were empty. They've been empty my whole life. And many of those buildings have fallen down or been torn down and they're not even here anymore. But Butte still has this incredible architecture from the 1880s really up to the 1920s. That's really remarkable. My building is right across the street from one of Butte's most beautiful buildings, the Finland Hotel on Broadway Street. And mine is less glamorous than that. It's just a two-story building on the corner of Broadway and Wyoming. But on the bottom is actually two commercial spaces. So that's the 101 and the 105 address. And so it's got large glass windows with commercial storefronts that were built that way to be storefronts and high ceilings. And then on the second floor, at some point, so it was originally two buildings actually that were joined, you know, with a wall. But at some point, the upstairs was conjoined together to become 103 East Broadway and made into five apartments. So I live in one of those now.
So there are four other units that are they fully habitable at this point?
Yes. I was fortunate in that this building was fully habitable in all aspects. So all of the apartments were livable and in pretty good shape. The building was the earliest records I've found of it. It shows up in the city directories as early as 1895. It could be even older. It's probably one of the oldest buildings on that block, older than the Finland.
Which is a big hotel.
Right, big hotel. Yeah. That building that's currently there was built in the 1920s. And so my buildings were remodeled a little bit in the 20s to add an awning that matches the awning on the sidewalk of the Finland and of the Thornton building, which is across the street. And then it was remodeled at some point in the mid-century, 1950s. So it has this sort of, you know, Victorian era meets mid-century style to it, which I love.
And what was the building originally?
Well, it's had many lives, some of which I don't even know about. So actually, if you go in the basement, which, you know, that area of Butte had underground tunnels, right, where people could walk under the sidewalks, and that area was part of that. So it had originally storefronts even in the basement of the two buildings. And I found a sign advertising, a Fisk Rubber Company, a handwritten kind of hand-painted sign. And I looked that up, and that was a company that sold tires like around 1905 for, you know, the first cars.
That's so cool.
That was in the basement at some point. On the 105, the smaller building was a boarding house and owned by a woman for a long time. So she lived there and her children lived there. I don't know if she's a widow or just a single mother or what her situation was, but I think she rented out rooms. And then 101 East Broadway was the business offices of the Butte Electric Company at the time. So like the first electric company. And then upstairs at one point in what is now my apartment, it was an assayer's office at some point. So, yeah.
Very fascinating. I mean, just that building, or you could probably pick, you know, several different buildings here in the uptown and just study the history of that building. It would tell you an awful lot about the Industrial Revolution and the history of the United States in and of itself, because it's all knitted together.
Yeah, absolutely. You can go into the archives and look at the city directories, and from certain years, you can look up the addresses and see what businesses were there from year to year.
It's fascinating.
Yeah.
So we were talking a little bit earlier about the unoccupancy rate or the occupancy rate in some of the older buildings here in the uptown. And if anybody, we don't know, and we don't even know if that is some data that someone has collected, but if you know, anybody listening out there knows what percentage of buildings here in the uptown area remain unoccupied, or what percentage of the percentage that are occupied, because many buildings, they have businesses in the basement, and they originally probably had other things, namely apartments in the upper floors, and they just kind of sit empty. Mm-hmm. Here in the Carpenters Union Hall and other buildings like it, they were just kind of taken over by the pigeons.
Yes.
So it's a daunting, daunting task just to clear out. It doesn't take a lot of imagination to figure out, to visualize what that might entail. So did you have, tell us a little bit about your experience after you bought the building and a little before and after maybe.
Yeah. So when I moved back to Butte, I had the intention of investing in a building. I thought I need a project if I'm going to move home. And, you know, my plan was basically to buy the nicest building I could with my money, because I'm not, personally, I don't really know how to fix up anything, to be honest. And I figure I'm smart enough to figure out who to hire for it and negotiate those services, but I don't know how to do it. So my building was in pretty good shape, but it still had issues, as all old buildings do. And those issues will go on for the rest of my life. So it had in the corner, the southwest corner, so the downhill facing corner, the foundation was starting to sag. It was sort of partly concrete, but also wooden beams that were rotting and caving in. So when the water would run down the hill from rain, there was actually a hole in the sidewalk and it would run right into the basement. So that was kind of an urgent need that needed taking care of. So I got some pretty serious foundation work done really early on, in which they actually jacked up the building about an inch, which was pretty crazy.
A whole two-story building being lifted.
I didn't realize how scary that was. The contractor actually told me as they were doing it, you know, he's like, Carie, I'm scared. And I said, don't tell me you're scared. I didn't even know to be scared, you know, but it all worked out. They did a great job. So that was the major thing. And then the roof needed replacing. The roof was still fine, but definitely at the end of its life. It was an old asphalt and gravel roof. And my first winter in Butte before it was replaced, so this winter prior to this one, there was a couple heavy snows there in the spring. And I started to even see some moisture, you know, coming through the ceiling. And it made me real nervous. But I got the roof replaced this last summer, and I'm real happy about that. So those have been the two big projects that I've taken on.
So I wanted to create a little context for your award. I'm not exactly sure how to say this without sounding maybe a little snobbish, but, you know, some people might say, well, gosh, she bought a building, you know, why did she win this award?
Because that's
she
what got I said. Right? When I got the award.
But really, the significance to the community. Why is this such a big deal? I mean, it in my mind, it really is a big deal. Why is this so important to Butte?
Well, thanks for asking that question. I mean, I'll be honest, I had no idea this award was coming. And when they called me to tell me, I was completely bowled over. And my first reaction was, I'm not an entrepreneur. You know, I don't even know why you chose that. Yeah, it was just really caught me off guard. But I was so incredibly honored. You know, I guess, I mean, I do. Yeah. And I realized I do have a pretty strong philosophy about it. In choosing to move back to Butte, you know, I realized I could probably invest in real estate anywhere, but I'm not really interested in investing in real estate per se. I'm interested in my hometown, and Butte, you know, for so long has had a hard go of it in many ways. And
yeah, I like to see it's a bit of a cross between Detroit and Flint.
Yeah, that's how I often describe Butte as the Detroit of Montana to people who've never been here, because, you know, it's blue collar, working class, industrial, and has experienced a lot of blight. So I think it's a fair assessment, you know, except for a much smaller scale. But to me, I think a place like Butte has so much to offer: the incredible architecture, our incredible history, the incredible community and people. And you know, and I know that because I'm from here and I'm very proud of it. So I felt like if I were to do anything with my life that I could be proud of, even if it ends up being a total failure financially, you know, I'd want to do it in Butte. So that was why I did it. And I also think that, having seen, you know, some communities grow very quickly, that I know for like the younger generation that Butte offers aesthetically a lot of things that I think a lot of young, you know, entrepreneurs would be really interested in investing in and opening small businesses. Living in Portland, there's all these great businesses and cool things and great food, and but I could never do anything in Portland. I could never open a business because I can't afford it. I could never compete either. But in Butte, you know, it doesn't take much, and anybody can do something if they want to. And that prospect really attracted me. And I realized, you know, I wanted to stop consuming and just being a consumer of life and actually produce something. And so Butte offers that opportunity. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah.
We're going to take a quick little break. Once again, when you mentioned that magical word, finances or financial, and then we'll say success after that word. We'll talk a little bit more about that when we come back. Thanks for listening.
I saw above me, then an endless skyway. I saw below me, that golden valley. This land was made for you and me. I roamed and rambled, and I followed my footsteps to the sparkling sands of a diamond dance. And all around me a voice was sad.
This is Heartstock Radio. I'm Carol Murphy, and we're here in the studio with Carie Coe. And we're going to cover a few more topics related to Carie's experience and the award that she won as Woman Entrepreneur of the Year, given to her by the Local Development Corporation. And Carie, you mentioned the word financial. So we have to bring that topic and discussion in, mm-hmm. I think. So, have you made any money?
I've made money. No, not yet. I have.
I like that answer. Not yet, as in yes.
Well, sure. Yeah. I mean, I'm doing this as sort of my retirement plan. Mm. You know, it's love I have it. A. How long is my loan? 20-year loan on the building. And so I hope to pay that off by the time I'm ready to retire and earn money from the, you know, rents. And hopefully by then I've made all of the big repairs that I need to make. But I did, you know, I didn't just like jump blindly into this either. I didn't know what I was doing, I'll be honest, but I did know that I needed to know what I was doing. As a good academic, I bought a book called How to Get Started in Rental Income, I think it was called it. And I read it front to back and I loved that. It was a great book. I highly recommend it. Very practical, and it taught me how to do cash flow worksheets. And so I love Excel. So I made up all these worksheets in Excel, and I learned how to, you know, kind of figure out whether an investment would cash flow. And the main thing being that it's got to at least break even at the very least, and, you know, have at least some positive cash flow in the within 5 years probably. And so I did those calculations, and it was actually very educational, because places that might look attractive, when you run the numbers on them, you find that actually it would be really hard to really keep it afloat after a few years. You know, it's not because you want to get rich. You just want to pay your property taxes and pay your bills, you know. And this property actually did cash flow, assuming that I can keep all parts of it rented out, you know, or most parts of it.
Yeah.
And I like the multi-use aspect of it. It's got commercial space and apartments. Yeah. It's zoned commercial. That gives me flexibility in what I do with the space. I don't have to seek zoning board approval to change anything I do in there. I can do what I want for the most part, you know.
Yeah. And fun. It sounds like really, really a lot of fun.
Gives me a lot of freedom. Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of risk, but with risk comes freedom. So I've been enjoying that. Yeah.
And then Daniel had a great question that I think we also can talk about. You know, part of Butte's current condition is that we're still a Superfund cleanup site. And yeah, how does that play into all of this for you?
Yeah, well, it's an interesting question. Having grown up here, and you know, we moved here the last year that the pit was still being mined, the Berkeley pit, and then the next year the mines closed and the pit started filling with water. And so my entire life has been watching Butte through some pretty hard times, and watching that pit fill with water, which has been horrible. But I have it's. It's a weird thing to say, but when you grow up with it, it becomes normal. So it didn't really factor into my decision. Butte is, I see the value in Butte and all the wonderful things about it. And the pit is an unfortunate thing that will be there forever. It's part of who we are.
Part of our legacy.
It's part of our legacy, and for good and bad. Mm-hmm. But it's right there, you know, it's, I don't know.
I see all of it as an opportunity, because we're not alone. In the United States, there are over like 3,000 Superfund sites. And that's doesn't even, if you extend beyond that to places like China and developing nations, you know, multiply that by exponentially by a factor of 10 or 20, who knows? Mm-hmm. So there are many places that we can help. Because it happened here first, we kind of went through the Industrial Revolution, and now the rest of the planet is kind of living through the same thing that we're in the midst of. So I see it as an opportunity, really.
Yeah, I mean, I know that Butte deeply influenced just me intellectually and all the things I did have done as an academic. I mean, I studied environmental politics in Vietnam, and I've always, I think after growing up in Butte, I've seen politics in terms of struggles over natural resources and struggles over class, you know, and owners of enterprise versus laborers, because that's what Butte's history is.
Yeah, and we were talking about this a little bit earlier, too, in Indonesia, where I just recently got to go. They're having the same problem, only it's the rainforest that's being kind of taken over by business. And
exactly. I mean, people are often critical of Butte because I think the visual aspects of our economic legacy are right in front of us, right? But the truth is the whole world is subject to the same dynamics. And if you think you're not part of it, you know, you're wrong.
Yes.
And I think in Butte, we're deeply aware of that, you know, in our history, more so than I think a lot of people ever have to be, and if they're privileged enough to not have to be.
Yeah. And it's, it's easy to say, to point the finger and say, you know, it's their fault. They did it.
Right.
But I had to myself kind of do a step back and say, well, you know, I think we all had a part in this. Mm-hmm. All the people that came here as blue collar workers who are part of my own personal family history, they all played a role.
Yeah.
You know, I was brought up on whatever game my predecessors, my great-grandparents experienced by coming here and working. Mm-hmm. You know, what was the alternative? Not to have a job.
Right. Well, yeah, I don't think, you know, people who worked in the mines ever thought in terms of morality of, it was survival.
Exactly. But it's all part of the same soup.
Yeah. I mean, and that's the stuff I studied intellectually is, you know, the political economy of development. It's those dynamics, it's political economy that leads to these things. And you need good regulation. You need careful oversight, in my opinion, strong democratic institutions and engaged populace, which I think KBMF is doing a good job of educating the citizenry and how to be better engaged with those things. Mm-hmm. But, yeah.
So we have a couple minutes left. Is there anything else that you'd like to say about your experience? I know that we haven't quite touched on another organization that you work closely with here in Butte that's related to the older buildings and redevelopment. Can you talk a little bit about that? I think we have maybe about 2 minutes.
Okay, yeah. I'm the public relations coordinator for Butte Citizens for Preservation and Revitalization, or Butte CPR. And it's a pretty natural fit for me. We advocate for the preservation and revitalization of Butte's historic architecture. So we kind of monitor what's going on politically about decisions to potentially demolish old buildings, for example, or planned uses for them. And we advocate, you know, and kind of are a watchdog group, educate the citizens, members, you know, about things that they might care about so that, you know, we recognize that Butte's assets are really in its history and its historic architecture, and it's for the benefit of our future that we preserve those things.
So if any of our listeners would like to get involved with Butte CPR or reach out to you, what's the best way for them to get in touch?
Well, they could email me at my Butte CPR email. It's info@buttecpr.org.
Thanks, Carie.
Thanks so much for having me. It's been an honor.
Yeah, I feel like I always feel this way, though. I feel like we have more to talk about. So,
oh, we have much more to talk about.
That's it for this program, and we'll see you next week. This is Carol Murphy, and you're listening to Heartstock Radio.
When the sun came shining, and I was strolling, and the wheat fields waving.
Heartstock Radio is a production of KBMF 102.5, Butte America Radio. Hear our live programs every Wednesday at 7 p.m. Mountain Standard Time via live stream at butteamericaradio.org.
As I went walking, I saw a sign there, and on the sign it said no trespassing, but on